And now, to have and now our special segment on Super Atragon, we now have Captain Warlock to present it to us.
Thanks, Peter. For the good old days. I remember when I was just a little warlock, growing up in New York City, sitting down one afternoon to watch a movie with old Grandpa Warlock. The movie was called Atragon, and it had it all, at least as far as I was concerned at that age. I mean, well, hey, the giant snake monster named Manda and a flying submarine with a drill bit mounted in its bow and an evil undersea empire bent on conquering the world. How can you go wrong, right? Well, Atragon was a 1963 Toho International live-action feature film directed by Ishiro Honda with special effects by Eiji Tsuburaya. That's the duo who brought us the Godzilla films. Atragon, in turn, can trace its roots all the way back to an 1899 novel entitled Kaitei Gunken, which was written by one Shunro Oshikawa. Well, now, it's probably been at least 25 years since I've seen Atragon, so I can't really vouch as to whether it was a good film or not. But I was very pleased, mighty pleased, to find an animated version of this beloved tale from my childhood entitled Super Atragon. Super Atragon is a two-part magnum opus from Toho Video written by Nobuaki Kishima and directed by Kazuyoshi Katayama, with character designs by Yoshikazu Yasuhiko and mechanical designs by Makoto Kobayashi. Each episode runs about 45 minutes in length, and I strongly suggest that they be viewed back-to-back to avoid confusion. The video tells the story of the crew of the super ultra-class undersea battleship Ra and its desperate battle to save the human race from extinction. It seems that an unknown enemy is using massive microwave generators to melt the polar ice caps. When a multinational naval force is sent to thwart this insidious plan, the bad guys quickly destroy it without very much trouble. As is usually the case in these sorts of situations, conventional and even nuclear weapons are useless against the enemy. They possess a technology far in advance of our own. And in addition to using microwaves, they have other nifty weapons such as gravity lenses, which they can use to crush submarines and battleships like old empty beer cans. So what can hope to stand against such awesome power? Well, here's a clip. Let's take a look.
あの円柱を破壊できる兵器があるとすれば。 それは菅原レポートにあった。 海底軍艦ラゴーのみということになりましょう。
左90度、1番および副砲塔右90度旋回、プラズマ弾装填。
Now, I know what you're thinking. It's an undersea battleship, right? So what's it doing flying through the air? Well, take it from me, Captain Warlock. This baby can do just about everything. Equipped with a wicked bow drill, artillery up the yin-yang, missiles, torpedoes, flying hydrojet submersible aircraft, and all protected by a magnetic shield, Ra kicks some serious booty. The novel, live-action film, and anime, all being produced by different creative talents over such a long period of time, don't really have very much in common as far as the story is concerned. In the novel, the enemies were pirates and those evil Russians, being that the novel was written during the Meiji period and the Russo-Japanese War. The live-action film dispensed with a lot of the more nationalistic messages of the novel and moved the story into the post-World War II period. And it had different characters and the threat of the evil Mu Empire replacing those pesky Russians. The anime is closer to the film than the novel, but not really by very much. Different characters, different motivations, and a different villain again mutate the story to an even greater degree. The one element that does bind all of these three works together is the Kaitei Gunken itself. Kaitei Gunken being the Japanese words for undersea battleship. Okay, it gets star billing in all three versions above the human characters. One question that may be on your mind is, so where does the name Atragon come from? In the novel, the ship was called Denko Tei, or Thunderbolt Ship. In the film version in Japan, it was called the Goten Go. In the anime, the ship is called the Ra. So where does Atragon come from? Atragon, it turns out, is a contraction of two words, Atlantis and Dragon. And this was a suggested title for the film's American release by the folks at Toho Studios, but the name was supposed to refer to the snake monster. The folks at AIP, the film's American distributors, apparently decided that they liked the name for the submarine better, so they stuck Atragon, they stuck the Atragon name onto the submarine. Why the name Atragon made it into the title of the anime, since nobody in America seems to remember the film, is something of a mystery. Among Super Atragon's strong points are the mechanical designs. Lots of real-life military hardware, such as F-14 Tomcats, Tomahawk cruise missiles, and naval ships, are prominently featured and rendered in high detail. For the more fantastic vehicles, such as the Super Ultra-class undersea battleship Ra, God, I love saying that, a retro tech style was used, which has lots of rivets and bolts visible, and lots of wheels and levers and analog controls and gauges, which give a wonderful antique flavor to the designs. Fans of Space Cruiser Yamato should love this one, and the personal travails of the crew members are both poignant and interesting. It was enough to give, it was enough to bring a tear to Mrs. Warlock's eye. Where Super Atragon fails is in its use of flashbacks and exposition. The first episode begins on the high seas in 1945 as World War II is wrapping up. Then it jumps forward to the present day, and then episode two starts in Manchuria in 1932 and then jumps ahead to the present day again to tell the rest of the story. There's a lot of backstory, which is sort of clumsily exposed in conversations between the characters, so all the cards really aren't on the table until about the middle of the second episode. And that's the confusion that I was warning you about earlier. Also, while the conflict comes to a satisfactory conclusion, the ending is left open for future episodes, and if they ever get made, well, I mean, hey, that'd be great, but if not, I think it's probably going to be a long time before somebody else picks up the Kaitei Gunken property. Super Atragon is actually one of those anime that's better the second time around once you know the full story. Despite its failings, it rates a solid B for its enthralling designs and overall entertainment value. It's got something for everyone, so go out and see it today and tell them the captain sent you.